So good afternoon, good morning, good evening. Thank you all you that are attending this new edition of the IEEE Speakers and Systems Society Rio Grande do Sul Talks. So today we have the pleasure here to have a Professor Luciano Agostini from the University of Pelotas in Brazil. Before giving the floor to Professor Sergio Bumpy from Federal University of Rio Grande do Sul, that will be the session chair today. So I give the floor now to Professor Sergio Bumpy to do the introduction of Professor Luciano Agostini. By the way, if you have questions, you can put your questions in the chat channel of YouTube. Then the question will be read to Luciano at the end of the talk. Also, if you are not yet, if you have not yet subscribed to the YouTube channel, you can do it by just clicking the subscribe button. And so thank you all that are attending this talk today. And now the floor is with Sergio Bumpy.
Okay, let's start then today's interesting talk being given by Luciano Agostini. As you all know, in Cyberland, you can access these videos in this series of CAS, Rio Grande do Sul Talks, in the YouTube archive of the CAS YouTube channel. So let me say a few words about Luciano. He is a professor at the Federal University of Pelotas since 2002. So he has been associated as a professor there for almost 20 years. He has a master and PhD from Federal University of Rio Grande do Sul in the field of computer science, working always in video coding. He is a distinguished researcher in the CNPq, the National Science Foundation of Brazil, level one. Classification in the research rosters of CNPq. He advises theses and master theses and PhD dissertations in the computer science graduate program at the Federal University of Pelotas. From 2013 to 2017, Luciano held the executive office of Vice Rector or Vice President for Research and Graduate Studies at the Federal University of Pelotas in the city of Pelotas. He has extensively published in this field more than 300 papers in journals and conferences. He is focused most of his life, I think, in 2D, in 3D video coding, algorithm optimization, arithmetic circuits, dedicated digital architectures for those type of functions. Currently, he serves as an associate editor of two IEEE Circuits and Systems journals, the Transactions of Circuits and Systems for Video Technology and Open Journal of Circuits and Systems. Without further ado, just reminding that Luciano has been active in many events of this CAS CAS Society, SPS societies, and Computer Society. He also member of several technical committees of those societies. So with no other extension, let us thank Luciano for agreeing to give this talk on video coding, looking at the state of the art and trends. He has more than 20 years experience since he started studying this field many decades ago. And has evolved over the time. So the floor is yours. And remember, you can ask questions in the YouTube chat session. And please be as participative as possible and ask questions for us to discuss at the end. They'll be answered at the end. Thanks a lot. Thanks, Luciano.
Thank you, Bapi. Thank you, Reis. Thank you for this nice presentation. Today I'm talking a little bit to you some aspects about the state of the art and trends in terms of video coding. It's an honor to me to be here talking in this event of CAS, Rio Grande do Sul chapter, and I will start my presentation now. Well, first, where I am here in South Brazil, almost in Uruguay, at Federal University of Pelotas City, and my research group, the research group where I'm working in this theme is the Video Technology Research Group. And as Professor Bump said, I'm currently advising PhDs and dissertations at graduate program on computer at the same university. We have opening positions. Then, if you are interested, I can send additional information to you. Well, here is a Zoom in this location where the university is presented in the city. We are near to that big lagoon called Ducks Lagoon, and also near to the ocean. And the university is really near this river, São Gonçalo River. Here we have the university, at least have a lot of buildings around the city, but this is the main one, and is where the computation is situated. Here we have some pictures of other buildings of our university. We have some important historical buildings. And considering the group, the VTech group, we have nowadays 5 professors listed here. I'm very glad to work with these guys. And we have 28 PhD candidates nowadays, 12 master's students, 14 undergraduate students working exactly in this research subject. I will not present a lot of details of this picture, but our group is working with many technologies of visual signal representations, from still images, 2D, 3D, 306 videos, and also some new technologies like point clouds and light fields. For each one of these green boxes here, we have some undergraduate or some PhD student working with. But basically, we have two main focus of research. The first one is the development of algorithmic level solutions intended to generate new algorithms or to optimize some algorithm defined by some previous standards. And also we have the design of solutions, considering the system level solutions with dedicated hardware designs and other optimizations. Well, here, a brief summary of my presentation. I start with a very quick basic concepts. Then I will talk to you about the new encoder standard from ISO and I2T, which is the VVC encoder, which is the state of the art encoder nowadays. Some future trends and conclusions. Well, some basic concepts. A digital video is a sequence of still images, which are called frames. Here we have an example. If we have enough frame rates, we have the continuous perception of the movement. Then nowadays, depending on the frame resolution, we need something like 24 to 60 frames per second to have this movement sensation. And each frame is composed by 3 dimensional matrix with discrete points, and each discrete point inside this matrix are called samples, and a group of 3 samples inside this matrix exactly at the same position is called pixel. Okay, the way how we represent the color inside this 3 matrix is called color space. There is a lot of color space nowadays, and RGB is the most common one, but the video coding, the visual information coding in general, are using this type of solution with a system that represents separately the chrominance information and the luminance information, like Epsilon CBCR solution. Well, but what is the main challenge with digital videos? An example to observe the size of this problem is considering here a video with 24 bits per sample, per pixel. Then this means 1 byte per sample, a full HD resolution at a frame rate of 30 frames per second. And we are considering here 2 hours, which is a typical movie. How many bytes we need to represent these videos of compression? want to know. Well, we need first to know how many bytes you have inside each matrix of the video. Then we need to multiply the horizontal samples by the vertical sample, since each sample in this example have one byte. Then, since you have three matrices, you also need to multiply by three this value. Then now you have a total number of bytes that you have in one frame. If you multiply this by 30 frames per second, then we have the total amount of bytes that you need to represent 1 second of this movie. If you multiply this for the number of seconds that you have in 2 hours, then you have the final results, 1.3 terabytes to store or transmit only one movie. It's clear that it's not possible to handle this amount of information. Then we need to compression to allow the current applications like this one that we are doing today. It's very important to have efficiency in terms of compression. Okay. Netflix, for example, typically use 3 gigabytes in a 4G movie of 2 hours. Then this means that from 1.3 terabytes to 3 gigabytes, you have a compression rate of 450 per one. We also can reach even bigger compression rates, like 1,000 by 1, for example, depending on the query quality of each application and the type of encoder that we are using. But how these very high compression rates are possible? Basically, we explore 3 things to allow these very high compression rates. The first one is the data redundancies. We have a lot of data redundancies inside the video, and then we can try to remove these data redundancies without impact in terms of image quality. It can represent exactly the same information, but with using less data. The other thing that is explored is the behavior of the human visual system. The human visual systems has some behavior that can be explored. For example, the very high frequencies are less important for our visual systems. For example, the color information is less important than the information of luminance. Then this also can be explored, and so on. And finally, we can use some variable encoding solution to explore the probability of occurrence of the samples. This means that when we have an unbalanced representation of the symbols in a representation, we can use less bits to represent the symbols which are more used. Well, here we have a very simplified diagram of which we call a hybrid encoder. Here we have the current frame that is being encoded. Typically, the first thing doing here is the partition. We need to partition this framing blocks to be processed. And one model that is not here is exactly the subsampling of color information. To explore the human visual system, we can subsample the color information. Typically, we use a 4:0 calibre, which means that we are using the half of vertical and the horizontal resolutions for chrominance components. And then this brings an important compression gains at the beginning of the process. Then we have the prediction step with interpredictions and intra-prediction. The interprediction will try to find for each block of the current frame, which block is most similar with this one inside the reference frames. Okay. Since you have a lot of redundancy in neighbor frames, you have a high efficiency in this step. Interframe predictions try to find the semilences inside the same frame. Then we can explore the redundancies here inside the same frame. And you have one on another prediction. You can currently still using the both predictions together, but with the prediction done, we can explore the idea of data redundancy. Okay, But the prediction is not perfect. Then we need to generate the difference between the original frame and the predicted one. And this frame is then transformed to frequency domain. Why? Exactly to explore again the human visual systems. And then at the frequency domain, you can remove those frequencies which are less important to the human visual systems, or else we can attenuate some of these frequencies. And finally, we can use explore the probability of occurrences from the symbols generated by the quantization through the entropy coding to use the variable length solutions to compress this information. Quantization typically will generate sparse matrix with a lot of zeros, then we have a very unbalanced probability of occurrences, and this is very good for entropy coding works with. We also have inside this encoder an inverse path here, which is means that you have the inverse transforms and quantization. Why? Because the quantization process generated losses. Is a loss operation. And then, since we need to have exactly the same frame reference used at the encoder side and at the decoder side, we need to store as reference for the future predictions not the current frame, but the current frame reconstructed. This means we need to consider these losses generated by the quantization. Okay, and finally, we have the loop filter. Typically used to improve the subjective quality of imaging because you have a processing of blocks block by block, and then you can use different encoding tools and you can have some distortion, some artifacts also generated by high quantization steps and so on. I will talk about these questions today. Well, now we are able to start the discussion about the VVC encoder, which is the state of the art encoder. But previously, here we have a brief history of the main and most important video encoders in the literature. We have here the families of encoders generated together by ISO and ITUT standardizations organizations. The first one was defined in 1988, the MPEG-1, and then in 1994, the MPEG-2 was defined, which was really very famous. Some years later, we have in 2003, the MPEG-4 Part 10, and the AVC, which is the AG-264, this standard is used in the Brazilian system of digital television, for example. More than years, we have the HVC, and now, in some more than 7 years, we have the VVC, the versatile video coding, which is the most recent video encoder from this family. We also have other encoders from different companies. These efforts of many different companies were joined to generate the AV1 in 2018. And the main idea here is to have a very efficient encoder, but without hoax. The solutions defined by the ISO and the ITUT have a lot of hoax, and this is a problem for the industry, not only considering the value that is necessary to pay, but also there is a big confusion about for who have the intellectual property rights in this question. There are a lot of judicial discussions and so on. Well, here we have a curve extracted from this work here relating compression efficiency and the time. Compression efficiency here, we are talking about how many bits are necessary to generate a certain video quality. There is a relation between number of bits and video quality, okay? And this relation is improving a lot with the years. Nowadays, we are here with the VVC targeting very high resolutions like ultra high definitions, 8K, for example, and virtual and reality and so on. But the last decades were really very, very important to improve the video code efficiency. But naturally, you have a cost involved, and this cost is not low. But I'll talk just about this in the next slides. Well, the versatile video coding is then the state of the art nowadays, and the group of experts from ITUT and ISO was called the Joint Video Experts Team, JVET, and the final standard was defined in 2020. The main goals was to reduce or to increase, sorry, the coding efficiency in something like 50%, double the compression efficiency if compared to the predecessor, the UVC. Okay, all the reference all the standards have a reference software published that is freely downloaded from this case in this address here. From the VVC, the name was VVC Test Model, the VTM, and then the experiments were done inside this software to define the standards first and then to improve the standard for considering future works. VVC focused on a variety of applications. It's a versatile solution. Then conventional applications like the one supported by the HVC, for example, in addition to the videos, high definition videos have also a lot of tools intended to improve the coding efficiency of this type of video. An interesting solution adopted here is the adaptive streaming with resolution changes. Then you can have a streaming of a video and you can change the resolution of the video without need another streaming of video. Then we can have a high resolution video and can change this stream to an ultra high definition video, and then you can change again for a high definition video resolution, and then without changing the streaming. It's very, very nice for a lot of applications. We have tools also intended to stream content to videos. You have some solutions targeting ultra low delay streaming. It's very important, especially in this type of communications or conferencing broadcasting, for example. Also, we need to have a very small latency between the video capturing, encoding, transmitting, and decoding at the other side. We also have some tools targeting immersive video and 3D videos also. In this case, the traditional, but the multi-view plus depth solution used in HVC is not supported here, yet, at least. You have six profiles defined to the three main operations focused in the beginning of the standard. The first one was the conventional streaming, which is the main profiles. The other one is multi-layer solutions. The main idea to use multi-layer is to use a multi-layer solution to provide support to scalability, where you have a low resolution video and then another layer with improved resolution and so on. And also for 3D videos, where each layer can be a different viewpoint, a different camera, generated this information. And we have also solutions for still pictures. This means that it's tough video only for still pictures. And now solutions are using 10 bits per sample, not 8, as in HVC, for example, and supports color subsampling or not. Then the profile is 4x4x4, means that in this case you don't have color subsampling. And the other profiles allow a subsampling for 2-0 as presented before. Okay. Well, here we have a little bit more detailed diagram of the encoder. This is very similar with the previous previous image generic solution I showed to you, but here we have a little bit more details. For example, we have the transform and quantization, inverse transforms and quantization. We have the in-loop filters, here, you have the names of these filters. I will talk about these filters. You have the intra-picture prediction, inter-picture prediction, motion estimation, and so on. You have also a combined inter-prediction, which is a novelty. We also have some additional filters like this Luma mapping and Kramer scaling, which are used to improve the coding efficiency. And also you have some estimations and control information. All these informations, the information from the video itself, which are the quantized transform coefficients, and also the control information must be encoded by the entropy coder, which is the KBAC here. Okay. Well, the first thing I will talk specifically about the VVC is how the VVC do the partition of the frame. It's very important thing because it's a very complex structure that is allowed by the VVC. Then each frame is divided in squared block called coding tree units. Okay. This coding tree units can be sized, squared size from 32 by 32 to 128 to 128. Luminance, naturally samples, and if you have color subsampling, then we can subsample the chrominance considering this rate. The HVC also has the CTU concept, but there the size allowed were 16 by 16 to 64 by 64. Why we are increasing the size? Because we are increasing the video resolutions that we can support with higher video resolution. We tend to have more homogeneous areas that are being encoded, efficiently encoding using bigger block size. Well, this first partition is then partitioned using a very high flexible solution called quadro tree with nested multi-type tree. In this case, we have at least two trees that I will explain later to you. And each leaf of this tree, the KTMT tree, is called coding unit. Okay, here you don't have the concept of prediction unit separated from the coding unit. Also, you don't have the concept of transforming unit. Then these two concepts, transforming unit and prediction unit from HVC, were not used here. The CU size can vary from the size of the CTU, 128 to 128, to 4x4, considering luminance samples. And we have also can have an independent tree, completely independent tree for chrominance when we are considering the intra prediction. Well, we can have quaternary, binary, and ternary partition. Firstly, the quad tree is applied, then we have support only quadratic partitions, only squared partitions, and then when we have a leaf of this first tree, we can start another tree, which is called multi-tree, allowing binary and ternary partitions. Then when we have a final quadratic partition, we can also apply this type of divisions on two horizontal or vertical blocks, or these solutions with an balanced division between the frames, but dividing the block in three parts. Here we have an example of partition where the CTC have firstly four partitions, quadratic partitions. In this case, you start a binary partition and stop. And in this case, for example, we have another quaternary partition, and then we have a binary partition, a horizontal binary partition, and finally you have a vertical ternary partition. Okay, why you have this flexible structure? Because we have some situations like this one. This is a zoom in a picture. You have a lot of homogeneous regions in the sky, but in the tower we have a lot of details. Then you use very small blocks to encode the details, to have a good prediction of the details, and you use big blocks to encode the homogeneous regions. Okay, and this structure can adapt all these situations. Well, now I divided the discussion considering the tools, typically tools available for predictions. Then I talk about intra-inter predictions, I talk about the transforms and so on. First, we consider the intra-prediction. Again, the block size are not increased in this case, but we have more block size lowered in comparison to the GVC because now we are supporting also rectangular blocks, okay? Then we have 70 possible block size, CU size, where the GVC supports only 5, okay? We have the same planar and DC modes used in GVC. We have 65 angular modes now, are present in this picture, okay? Where in the GVC we had only 33. The angular modes try to use the neighbor samples in the borders of the block to be predicted, and use some type of field filtering, we can generate a prediction considering these directions. But we also have new tools like the multiple reference lines. In AGVC, you can use only one line and column in the neighbor regions to predict a block. Now we have used three lines, reference lines. We also use the matrix-based interpredictions, another, a new mode of prediction based on neural networks. And it's the first learning-based solution in a video code standard. Instead of the training is all offline, and then we have only matrix that can be used in this case, but these matrix were generated to learning-based solutions, okay? We also have a wide-angle interprediction. Why? Since you have rectangular blocks, this means that now some angular allowed by the 65 modes are not useful, and other angles could be better useful considering this behavior. Then we can increase, in some case, the number of angles, decreasing, we can increase some angles, decreasing other angles, okay, to maintain the same 65 angles. Then this solution adapts the number of prediction angles to better encode the video. We have also the intra-subpartition solution. Now, if you have, for example, here this partition, we can divide this partition in four horizontal or vertical directions and the blocks, sub-blocks, and then we can encode first, for example, here this block, and then we can use as reference for doing to encode the second block the samples in this neighbor region, which was generated for the first encoding. Then we have more accurate reference samples, and this means that you have a better prediction. But on the other side, you have a problem, which is the data dependence here. You just can start the second prediction here after finish the first one. We also have cross-component linear model prediction, where we can use the prediction we use defined for luminance and you reuse this definition to chrominance. It's very useful. And also you have a position-dependent prediction combination. This means that for some modes, some angular modes, and for planar and DC, we can improve the prediction combining this initial prediction with the boundary reference samples with another value, and then we can weight the solution, and the weight of these modifications depends on the prediction mode and the sample location. Well, now considering the interprediction, we have also some novelties. First, here you can use all the CU size defined allowed by the standard from 128 to 4x4. And this means that we are increasing the size in comparison with the HVC. We have now 28 CU size allowed, and HVC we have only 25. The basic motion estimation and motion compensation process are the same using HVC, but we have some new tools. This is one. Geometric partitioning mode. The idea here, I don't know if you can see this example, is not very big, but if you use only rectangular blocks to represent the image like this one, we have this type of behavior when we are predicting this type of image border. Then you can see that if you can use some different partition, we can represent much better this border between the guy and the background. And you even using bigger blocks, this means that we have a better prediction, and also you can use bigger blocks. And using bigger blocks is very good because you have less side information to be encoded. Okay, then the geometric partition allows the solution with one angle of partition together with an offset to define where this angle will be applied. And then with just two informations, we can have 64 partitions allowed from some types of CUs, not for all types, but this is causing important gains in terms of compression. Naturally, this is an additional partition using a diagonal, typically a diagonal solution, and each one of these parts of these blocks must have their own prediction, okay? To do that, but it's very, very nice solution. Another solution also included in the AV1 standard encoder is the affine motion compensation. Typically, the video code standards focus only in translation motion and not support other models like scaling, rotation, shape changes, sharing, and so on. Then the standards now are included in this type of model. For example, here we have this plane, and the plane had a rotation and also a scaling. And then how I can represent efficiently represent this in my prediction? Then you need to have additional tools. In this case, we use two motion vectors, the translation motion using typically only one motion vector, then now I need two motion vectors. But you can represent this type of movement with a very high level of efficiency. And this model uses four parameters with two motion vectors. We also have more complex movements using six parameters and three motion vectors, like this one, where we have three movements. We have rotation. We have naturally, in both cases, we have also translation, no? But we have a translation, rotation, scaling, and shearing in this case. Then we have three motion vectors, and we can do a very good partition in this case. Well, another novelty is not exactly the novelty, but the VVC included a lot of tools to improve the mesh prediction. The mesh prediction, the idea is not to consider the image itself, but exactly the side information, the movement, the motion parameters. Then the idea is to have tools to group this side information for many CUs. Then, for example, here, if you have an efficient process here, you can reduce the information, the side information, grouping all the side information for big regions. Okay, this means the original image is still partitioned. Okay, but now the same motion parameters are reused for many CUs. And this allow a very big compression. The VVC include the JGVC also have the mesh prediction, but now the VVC included new tools, history-based motion prediction, where you can reuse motion predictions from more distant blocks, pairwise average MV candidate, where you can use the last two mesh prediction candidates, and you do a single average and reuse this information to represent my block, and so on. I have sub-block based temporal motion prediction, mesh with motion vector difference is an important solution. We can now have a difference between two vectors to be used in the models here. Also, you have the symmetric motion vector difference, then you can, if you have some symmetric vectors, you can reuse the explore the symmetry between the vectors to avoid the representation, and so on. And these things are all used together with the previous solutions from HVC to increase the efficiency of this process. We also have a lot of other new tools inside the interprediction, like the BIP prediction with CO level weights. It's a new way to do the BIP prediction with fixed values of weights. We have adaptive motion vector resolution when we can apply the motion vector doubling, multiplying by a factor or dividing by a factor the first Nigbur motion vectors. We have the decoder side motion vector refinement, which is you can generate at the encoder side only some parameters of this motion vector, and the final refinement is done inside the decoder. You have two solutions, one targeting the bidirectional prediction and the other one the prediction but focus on fine modes, but using the optical flow concept. The idea is, yes, if I'm trying to get the movement of an object and I have I can have the perception of this movement, I can infer where this block will be in the next frames, and then we can improve a lot the prediction in this case. Okay, well, also we have the combined inter prediction, as I said before. Also we need at least 6-4 samples inside the CU to allow this mode. And basically we can combine a mesh mode defined by the interprediction together with a planar mode defined by the interprediction. And then we can do a weighted combination of these two predictions to generate the final prediction, okay? Well, in terms of transforms and quantization, we also have a lot of novelties, okay? The first thing is that the VVC supports bigger size of transforms to 64 by 64, but also this is the first standard of the ISO and the ETU that can also apply the transforms over rectangular series. The previous standard, like the GVC, is only quadratic tails or only squared series. Then this means that now we have much more options of series that can be encoded and can be decided. And also, since we are using the separability property, here we can use a difference transform for horizontal transformation and another one for vertical transformation. Since you have three types of transforms, we need a tool to select which transform is better to be used in each case for each size of block, for each horizontal or vertical direction. Basically, you have three types of transforms here, the DCT tool used in 3C, but also the DCT-8 and the DCT-7, okay? Also, we have the transform skip mode. In some cases, better do not do the transformation. Then, in this case, the transform is skipped. You have also a secondary transform applied after the first transform. You can apply a secondary transform called the low frequency no separable transform, intended to be used only for intra-predicted series to better support some properties of this type of CU. And finally, you have another crazy tool called the sub-block transform. This means that we can define, can have a CU, and we can define only a region of the CU that must be transformed, and the other region of the CU are skipped. Okay, then you can think that we have a lot of complexity here. In terms of quantization, the quantization parameter was increased to 63, intended to allow highest compression rates, okay? And also have the adaptive chroma offset where you can infer the quantization parameter from luminance, from chrominance, using the quantization parameter used in luminance, and then you can infer different TPs from the two chrominance components. It's very useful for high dynamic range solutions. It also have dependent quantization where we can use two scalar quantizers, and we define which was is the best one in each case, and is not allowed in the HVC, for example. Well, the entropy coding is very similar with the HVC solution. You also use the Kabak, and but now since we have other tools, not about size and so on, then additional coefficient group size are also defined to better do the entropy coding. Okay, and also the model used to do the encoding was changing to a more efficient one called the multi-hypothesis probability predicted model. And in this case, we use two estimates, also two independent estimates to define the values of the Kabak items. Now, considering the loop filters, we have some filters. Again, in this step, the complexity increased a lot compared to HVC. First one of all, we have the blocking filter using to reduce blocking artifacts. As I said before, we have the processing of many different blocks using many different tools. And then use the blocking filter, which is very similar to the used in the HVC, but also with a lot of improvement. You have also the SEMP adaptive offset, the SAL, which was defined by also in HVC. In this case, use exactly the same filter. Use it to attenuate the ringy artifacts. The ringy artifacts are generated when we have a very high quantization step around the high frequency regions. For example, a line in a picture, then in a draw, for example, then you have black and whites, and in this region we can have some ringing effects, and these filters tend to reduce this type of effect. But now we also have two versions of the adaptive loop filtering. The first version of the HVC are intended to use the LF, but at least the final standard remove this filter. Now it was included. The idea is to further correct the signal, improve the signal quality. And we have two filters, one for luminance and the other considering cross components. This means luminance and chrominance. And finally, you have another filter also, as I also said before, the luma mapping with chroma scaling. The idea here is to better balance the signal range to improve coding efficiency. It's not only used to improve the visual image quality, but to improve coding efficiency, and very interesting also. This filter modifies the dynamic range of the input signal. Well, comparing VVC with HVC, we have different comparison with different words, but considering these two words here, we have 4 to 13 times more complexity, more time to encode if compared to HVC. And also we have compression rates between 18 and 84% higher than HVC, okay, depending on the type of encode selected. Here we have another work, this guy's here, another evaluation. Considering the heated distortion curves, the solid lines here are the ones generated by the VVC reference software, the VTM, and the dashed lines here are the ones generated by the HVC reference software, the AGM. For different configurations, I am not tell about this, but the most important thing here, as you can see, is that you can have a highest quality for a same bit rate for all points considered. Then the VVC is more efficient than the HVC, and we have very good results in terms of this relation between quality and bit rate. Here we have some comparison considering complexity, and then considering the decoder here. we have something like that, 1.7 times more complexity in the VTM, when in the VVC, when compared to the AVC for different resolutions. When we see the encoder scenario, the problem is bigger. We can have here almost five times on average more complexity than the one reached by the HVC, and also you have a bigger variation here of values. This means that depending on the video, the complexity grows more or less. Okay. Well, the new VVC tools increase a lot the processing effort, as you can see in these graphs. And this is one of the main challenges to allow the dissemination of this standard, especially because nowadays we have a lot of battery-powered device, and then in this case we need solutions able to run within the limited resources that we have in our smartphones, for example. Well, which is the size of this new challenge? Only an example for you. Using the VTM and a very good computer here, you can use typically 50 minutes to process only one frame, considering the full HD resolution. This can naturally change considering different tools and so on, but 50 minutes is a good number for us. Then, considering that example, using a movie with 2 hours and 30 frames per second, then how long we will need using the VTM to process this video? 6.2 years. Bro, the complexity is really crazy. Naturally, it's fair to say that this software is only a proof of concept and a tool used to evaluate the encoding tools. It's not a commercial software. You can use a lot of solutions in software to improve the efficiency, but even with the solutions, we still have a very, very high complexity, which is a big problem for us. Typically, the test sequence will be you have a few seconds. Okay. Well, a realistic scenario naturally requires severe algorithmic optimizations, and dedicated hardware is really essential. We have here only a table to show to you some published works targeting to algorithmic optimizations for VVC. We have a small number of papers published in this issue yet. You can see here that most of the works are focusing on the partitioning, since this is a very complex structure. The idea is to reduce the KTMT tree to reduce the coding time, but with minor impacts in terms of complexity and in terms of coding efficiency. Then you can see here, for example, these works from my group. We have a solution with less than 1% in bit rate. This means that for the same quality of the original VVC, our solution now needs 1% more bits to represent the same video. But we have 30% of complex reduction. It's only one example. We have a lot of other works here. Most of them focus on partitioning. One here focusing on transform also, and with different results. But I'm not detailed here, it's only to show you that we have a lot of work to be done yet, considering this case. Considering the hardware designs, you have also a very small number of works, some of them focusing on the decoder side, other at the encoder side, and for some models, transforms, we have a lot of works focusing on transforms, some works focusing on interprediction, and one focusing on interprediction. Why? These tools are really very complex in the new standard, then are natural candidates for hardware design. The authors use different technologies and also reaching different results in terms of throughput. But again, we have a lot of work here to be done yet to have hard designs, complete hardware designs for VVC. Then, in terms of algorithmic optimizations, you need to solutions intend to drastically reduce the encoder complexity, but also thinking in some issues related to hardware issues. For example, we need solutions also that reduce memory communication, if possible. This means solutions that does not use a lot of data from reference frames, for example. Also, solutions that allow massive parallelism exploration in software and hardware is very important. For us, it's not interesting to have a solution able to reduce the complexity of the encoder when running in the general purpose processor, for example, but that have a very a lot of data dependencies. Then this data dependency will be a problem when we can explore the parallelism. Considering the hardware designs, you need hardware able to support all VVC encoding tools. You don't have this hardware available yet. And to reach very high throughputs to support the current and the future resolutions, and also trying to consume as low energy as possible. Then we have naturally a big problem here. And together with this problem, we have another one that all the solutions must have minor impacts in terms of coding efficiency. Then it's not easy to find algorithms and hardware solutions able to attend all this to support all this desired characters. Okay, it's not easy to do that. Then we have a lot of challenges here. Well, now to finish my presentation, I'll talk a little bit about trends. Well, here is very interesting graph from Zhang and other authors showing in 5-axis spatial resolution, time, view angles, spectrum, and quality, which are the main features of visual signal quality. Let's see. And where we are now. Now we are here in this light yellow region. We have, for example, quality of the visual signals are medium. We are typically using 10 bits per sample, like in the VVC. We support 2D videos and also some solutions like stereo videos, but it's not so popular yet. We have 30 frames per second, but we're also almost using 6 frames in some applications. In some cases, we are already using. And also, the typical resolution used is the Full HD, but also have other applications using UHD resolutions. But in near future, expected to have high or ultra high quality. To do that, we need to increase the bits per sample to 16, 12, 16, and 24, for example. And then we can be able to have more immersive solutions like point clouds, multi-view, and 3D in general, 360 videos, virtual reality, and so on. This means that we need also more frames per second, and we need support to bigger resolutions. And in the future, we need to have realistic visual signals, 100 of bits per sample, then applications like fields and volumetric virtual reality will be available for us. Probably we need more than 1K frames per second and a billion pixels per frame. Then, this means, naturally, the scenario is going on. And in terms of visual signals and videos, you can see now that the resolution, frame rate, bit depth, quality, and view angles are increasing. Other point here is that the popularization of different types of visual content, for example, 3D videos, 360 videos, virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality, these are even more options that are available for us. And then this means that we have much more information to be processed, compressed, stored, transmitted, and so on. This scenario is also increased with the new types of visual content, like point clouds, for example. As I said before, point clouds now, instead of you have a 2D representation of an object or a scene, now you have a volumetric representation of this object. This means that now we don't have more pixels, we have voxels. And the voxels are defined exactly where this point is in the space. And then we can naturally have this type of movements around the reconstructed object. We can see all the face of the objects, and we can have a very realistic view options. A lot of museums in the world are doing that in the virtual solutions. We also have light fields. Light fields is another way of representing images. For example, we can refocus the images. And this is a very interesting thing, but now we can have in each point of each pixel, now we have other informations related to the light fields that are at each points of the image. And also we have holograms, for example, and this solution is not so rare yet to be used, but there is a lot of research to support holograms also. All this scenario brings important consequences for us. First one, an expressive increase in the amount of data required to represent the visual information is expected. I need much more data to get this visual information and the representation of this visual information. If you have much more data, then you need much more powerful coding engines to allow the compression that you need to use this type of information. If you have more powerful coding engines, then you need more computational effort to process these encoding solutions. And finally, if you have more computational effort, you have naturally more energy consumption. Then this is a big problem for us, for our community, for our CAS community. It's very important to us to be considering these challenges for the near future. Naturally, algorithmic optimizations and hard designs are more essential than ever. Some research opportunities here. We can together develop the algorithms, or at least the algorithm optimization, together with the hardware design. Then we can do the definition of the algorithm thinking on the future hardware design. This is very important nowadays. The standardization committees are considering this type of solution when defining the tools. Also, the use of machine learning, deep learning, are promising solutions for this area. We have a lot of work nowadays using this type of solution with important gains in terms of coding, complexity of the coding process. You also can use some heuristics, or also machine learning, to spot the high correlation between spatial temporal view angle test with depth data. This means there is a lot of redundancy of data in this information that can be explored. You can also use heterogeneous systems. This means that this is a good solution for this type of application. Approximate computing is mandatory. Professor Claudio did a presentation about this in a few weeks ago in this channel. And also today, we have some groups in the world working with autoencoders. Autoencoders is the idea, that all the encoding tools that I presented to you are not necessary, and then you have only one idea, the use of one very well done neural network that is able to learn with the input frames and then compress these frames. Okay, learning completely from the input images. Naturally, we have some results now. The results is not so good than the VVC results, for example, but since the idea is starting to be explored, we can think that this solution can be used in the in a few moments in some future to real applications. Well, finally, I'm concluding my talk. To conclude my talk, I need to say to you that the visual signal coding in general is still a hot topic, as I said to you. Video, considering 2D, 3D, 306, point clouds, light fields, holography, there is a lot of things that are showing to us that you need to better explore the solutions to generate more efficiency in terms of encoding, but also in terms of hardware aspects. There are several challenges to realize visual signals coding, as I said to you, and the problem is that these challenges will only grow as the time goes, since the quality requirements are increasing and will increase a lot in the near future. The immersion also is exponentially being popularized through virtual reality, 360 videos, augmented reality, mixed reality, and so on. We have also new types of visual signals like point clouds and light fields and holography and so on. Then the problem is still growing. And then we need to conclude now that the complexity of coding algorithms will increase a lot in the near future to handle with this scenario. And you have a lot of open research opportunities here. From the algorithm perspective, we need ultra-low complex solution with high compression efficiency to allow real-time visual coding systems. Learning-based solutions, as I said to you, and also approximate computing are promising solutions to be explored here. And from the hardware perspective, ultra-efficient dedicated hardware solutions provide high throughput and low energy are mandatory. Okay, and application of knowledge-based solutions tends to maximize this result. Well, with this, I am finishing my presentation. Thank you. And now I'm open for questions.
Thank you, Luciano, for your very clear and nice presentation. This great overview of EVC and the new trends and issues involved. We have three questions here from the chat in the YouTube channel. I'll read the first one coming from Chenet. Let me see here the question. Cristiano Chenet. Thank you, Luciano, for the clear presentation. The question is, please, could you give us some examples of applications that are already using VVC encoders?
No, I cannot. I'm sorry. The commercial solutions are being developed at this time. The standard is very new, but the idea is that this solution will be able, as nowadays the HVC are able in our cell phones, our televisions, and many other applications, the VVC tends to be a new standard also to be available to be used from streaming for other applications inside the internet, for example. But it's important to say that Google, Netflix, and other companies, very important companies in this area, developed their own encoder called AV1, and now they are trying to develop the AV2. And the idea, their idea is to use only this standard, their encoder is not a standard because it's not standardized, but their encoder to streaming applications, for example. Because the idea is a solution, a higher to less solution, but the idea is very good. The solution they provide is not very good. The coding efficiency is not so good in first time. And the second problem is that a lot of companies around the world are starting some process saying that some technologies used in AV1, for example, are already protected with patents, then they have royalties associated. it's a discussion. I don't know how the discussion will be will finish, but the EV1 nowadays is the main competitor to VVC. But I believe okay. that VVC will be used in many devices in the near future. Okay, but the solutions are being developed. You can understand that the standard was recently defined, and the companies need some time to define new chips and solutions.
Thanks. It's fair to say that the movement that appeared 12, 15 years ago for VP, the big companies moving that direction, and now joining forces in AV as a joint effort from very powerful companies, they have a possibility to make an impact and put in a second levels of importance the standards that are coming out of the joint video team under the sponsorship of ISV and NTU. There are two questions from João Carlos Brito Filho. Thanks for...
Sorry, another comment here is important, that these companies defined their own encoding as AV1 or AV2, but almost all these companies are also working inside the JVET to define the VVC. They are working in two fronts. Then in some time they can choose which is the best one, but they are contributing with the VVC also. Right.
Yeah, I understand. But the patent issues and all those things start to be decided later on when they come to very large deployments. I'm talking about large deployments, commercial deployments. Well, João Carlos Brito, thanks, João Carlos, for two questions. He also thank you, Luciano, for this very nice lecture. And the first question coming from João Carlos Brito Filho. The process used in VVC is somewhat similar to NVIDIA's DLSS technology, but applied to smaller pixel arrays. Is that the case?
João, I'm sorry, but I don't know exactly how this DLSS solution is implemented. But I know that NVIDIA is also working inside the standardization process. Then maybe some ideas may be used inside the VVC. I'm sorry, I don't have the answer for this question.
Yeah, it looks like João Carlos is heavily interested, involved in software, dedicated software towards NVIDIA cards, NVIDIA platforms. So the second question is also related to, asking he's affirming that the VVC is compressed and decompressed, usually using processors or video cards or both. And he asked if the color tensor technology on the NVIDIA RTX cards can be used in this process. So it's a more general question on using GPU platforms from this very powerful commercial company, NVIDIA, in terms of running the VVC. But I think it can generalize for other video decoders also and encoders.
Yeah, what can you say about that? In general,
the compression and decompression, that's in streaming. So I was thinking about using that in streaming applications.
Ron, thank you for this question. In general, the final solutions for video coding, considering the state of the art standards, are not implemented in software, but are implemented in dedicated hardware. Okay, even the NVIDIA GPUs nowadays have some dedicated hardware used to do this type of encoding. I don't have now the board, but for example, there is one board from NVIDIA that already implemented a first version of the AV1 encoder. But the board supports AV1, but the AV1 is not decoded or encoded using the GPU, but using a dedicated hardware for that. We have some processors, many processors dedicated to embedded system, for example, cell phones, that they have their own dedicated hardware for decoded and encoded videos, for example, HVC and MPEG-2 and other standards. I don't have the examples here. I can show you in another moment, but our commercial solutions all commercial solutions nowadays needs to use some dedicated hardware to compress videos in real time, considering mainly considering the battery power device, but also the general purpose processor. The general purpose processor, that is not more a general purpose processor nowadays, they are socks. This processor also have dedicated hardware to compress and decompress videos and some standards, because the complex is very, very high. You need to have hardware support to do that.
Okay, yeah, John Carlos made a point that you know, NVIDIA in GPUs are, you know, are good, are a solution, possible solution for let's say supporting this this demand in this, you know, huge market for encoding video. So again, I have a question from Giovanna Gomes. Thanks, Giovanna. She's from the Unipampa in Bagé, in the south of Rio Grande do Sul. So Giovanna's asked a very simple question. How is VVC compared to AV1 in efficiency and compression?
Thank you, Giovanna. I answered this question in previous comments. In fact, AV1 is less efficient. Is less efficient than the VVC. It's much less efficient. AV1 is a little bit better than AGVC in terms of coding efficiency. And VVC doubled the compression efficiency when compared to AGVC. But AV1 is very interesting. I have a lot of students work with AV1 because they have an important future for this type of initiative. AV2 is a solution that is being to be constructed in the few months or years. I don't know how exactly the AV2 will be available, but in terms of code efficiency, the VVC is much more efficient. Much more efficient.
Okay,
the AV1 guys try to say that not. We have a lot of works with very specific cases being reported where the AV1 is better, but it's not true. It's
only but again, there's this issue of complexity. How long does it take to do the job? But let's move to a question by Leonardo.
The complexity is almost the same. It's almost the same. Because you see, the guys from AV1 must have solutions to reach a very high compression rate, but it's off using the most efficient tools, which because these tools are already protected for some patents. Then this is a big problem. They use much more complexity to solve the same problem. This is the main problem, considering the AV1 complexity. Then the AV1 is have more or less the same complexity of the VVC.
Leonardo Carlos asks if the current networks are capable of handling this new encoding.
they aren't, but they must do. They must be ready to do that. The problem is not encoding itself, but the type of media that we are consuming. If you are using Netflix and you have now a very big television in our home, you want to see videos in 8K resolution, and this is the main problem. If you are using very high resolutions, we need to have very efficient encoders engines to allow the bandwidth to have the bandwidth in an acceptable level.
Right, yeah. Leonardo, it's not a matter of the network capability. Network has a given capability for data transport. It's just that the video just, you know, requires bandwidth, and you know,
but
reducing that demand has to do with efficiency of the encoding. But you know, the capability of the networks are something that, you know, there is even a growing demand. Anna Mativi, she's from Federal University here. She thanks you for your talk. And thanks you, and also Professor José Zambuja, great talk, Luciano. He makes a very specific question, and he'll be speaking about that later on, I think in October, because Professor Zambuja is working on distributing a general data computation in the network between the source and the sink of the information. So the question from Professor Azambuja is it possible to implement or improve an encoder in this scenario?
Hello, Azambuja, thank you for the question. We need to really think better about this. I don't know exactly to answer you, to have a precise answer to you now. We have a lot of challenges, and I don't know if the scenario is a good scenario for video coding. I'm sorry, but we can talk later and to have a...
Yeah. It seems like, you know, in the end, you know, someone in a company who is generating the coded content, you know, has to take care of providing a content, distributing that data computation over the network. I think if it is in the premises of a given company, that looks okay, but not in the general network, right? It's mm-hmm. it's a very challenging proposition, and José Rodrigo Azambuja will be speaking about that in a few weeks from now. So there are several congratulations, and we have to close now. Amazing presentation from the best teachers. They congratulate here for you for the lecturing. There are many thanks, and on behalf of the Rio Grande do Sul Secrets and Systems Society, I thank you, Luciano, for this excellent talk and motivate people to this field. And thank you, Luciano, your final words.
Thank you, Bampi. Thank you, Hayes. Thank you for the audience, and I'm available for other discussions. If you can, please feel free to send a mail to me. Okay?
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, everyone.